presentation, I'm going to outline for you the student-owned learning engagement model. Put it in the context of some of the underlying foundations that have informed its development, particularly Laurillard's conversational framework, and you'll see that illustrated shortly. And then to talk about the ways in which one might actually implement this in practice and the kind of support that's available, which is the phase that we're at the moment. So it's worth noting, first of all, what the foundational thinking behind this idea is. Essentially, there are three elements to this which are worth bearing in mind. And if you're not familiar with these, you might want to go and find out a little bit more about them, because I'll make reference to them. First is John Biggs's constructive alignment, the notion that learning outcomes, assessment, and content must all be aligned to be effective. The second is a model of learning design, or conceptualizing learning, a framework called the conversational framework, the notion that learning takes place through a series of interchanges that may or may not be mediated by technology. And the conversational framework I'm going to come back to in just a second, because it's been hugely influential. And the third element is work by Grenier Canol, amongst others, around developing toolkits to try and turn some of these effective learning practices into a reality. And I'm going to come back at the end to why we're looking at toolkits in this context. I just want to spend a moment talking about the conversational framework, because it's been quite influential in higher education learning and teaching development in the last 10 years. There isn't scope here to explain it in enormous detail, but what you can actually see here illustrated is the entire framework, and it builds essentially across a number of different elements which together in variety of combinations reflect instructivist models of learning, constructivist models, social constructivist models, and sociocultural models of learning, all essentially by turning on and off various elements, if you like, within this grand conversation. And it's a really useful tool when you sit down and do professional development with academic staff around what it is they're trying to achieve and how they go about doing what they're doing. And there are some wonderful illustrations. If you search for this on the web, there are some fantastic illustrations of the conversational framework as applied to emerging technologies, or the conversational framework as applied to formative feedback, and so on. But it isn't the easiest tool to work with unless you do something with it, unless it's actually facilitated. And so that gave rise to a problem. And the problem was, how do you actually combine the alignment of learning outcomes assessment and draw in that learning design expertise that lies behind the conversational framework into something meaningful and practical for staff? So this has emerged as a model. This is a representation of the final model. And I'm going to show you the model as it's built and see whether or not it then works for you conceptually when we then come to look at the toolkit that's been adapted to go with it. There's two important things to bear in mind in looking at the model. The first is that staff's conception of how they might go about designing and the model of student engagement that we're looking to achieve may actually be working in different directions. So staff may well design things from the perspective of learning materials and then think about how they go about teaching. And student engagement is often assessment driven. So that contradiction is something to just bear in mind. So in Biggs's notion of constructive alignment, what we're looking to do is to align the graduate profiler attributes and program intended learning outcomes with paper or course intended learning outcomes. And this is something that essentially the student owns. This is the experience that the student is going to own. And what we're trying to do is to build a model that will encourage the maximum amount of learning engagement. So we often start that with the development of some learning materials. We then start thinking about how we might facilitate engagement with that learning material, the way in which we might punctuate that process. we think about some active facilitation that may take place beyond our initial tutor contact time. So this could be online facilitation, for example. We think about the kind of activities that we set up for peer learning. We might want to draw on the social context in which students are actually learning. They don't do all their learning on campus, even if they're on campus students. And they certainly, as extramural students, do an awful lot of their learning within a social context. And the question is whether we draw sufficiently on that social context in our learning design processes. The student has a personal context. They have prior learning. They have things beyond their social context, as I'm defining it here. They have things about themselves which are unique in terms of their own background, experience, perceptions, skills, and so on. And what we want them ultimately to be doing is undergoing a process of reflection, and then we are going to formally assess the attainment of their learning outcomes through some formal means and provide them with feedback. So this is the loop that I'm dealing with. And the reason that the model is presented in this way is that I think it's interesting we can look back at some of those grand theories that Laurillard's conversational framework is trying to capture and does so very well and overlay them onto this model. So the design of the materials and the student engagement essentially falls into that instructivism model. The facilitation that takes place, tutor-led, but to some extent also using peers, is around constructivism. The engagement of the social environment and social context, peer learning produces a social constructivist model of learning. An awareness of all of the interplay of the individual in their sociocultural context draws on some models of sociocultural learning. And these are each one subsuming the previous one, of course. And finally, in terms of contemporary models of learning, there's this notion of connectivism, the way in which the individual exists within a network. Now, that model that I've just described is one which is attempting to articulate the conversational framework, adapt the Biggs's constructive alignment best practices, and give rise to something that is practical for staff to use. And this has given rise to something that's actually really quite simple. And the example illustrated here is actually based around student workload calculation. It's an Excel spreadsheet. It contains, as you can see here on the left-hand side, categories for all of those elements of the model that have been described: feedback, assessment, reflection, personal context, social context, peer-moderated activity, tutor facilitation, tutor contact time, and the learning materials. And what staff are being asked to do is to describe the activity. In this case, this is for a week, but it could equally well be for a unit of some other indeterminate length, to describe the activities and assign nominal time that the student would be expected to engage in that activity. And the spreadsheet, simply put, generates that pie chart that's generated automatically and provides a visual representation of the activity that the student is intended to do. And this is intended to have three purposes, which will be explained in alternate presentations. Those are to be descriptive and illustrative for the purpose of the student. So giving the student a printout of this represents an advanced organizer for students. It's evaluative because it allows both the student and the member of staff to see the balance of workload that's being expected across each week and to compare perhaps weeks in one paper with weeks in another. And to an extent, it's developmental because it will allow a staff to look at the performance of students across a particular week or a program and decide whether in fact they want to make modifications by rebalancing the kind of engagement that's being expected of students. And it's the workload model that we're going to use as the basis for engaging with the student-owned learning engagement model in more general terms.